I'm Dustin Abbott, and I'm here today to give you my definitive review of the Voigtlander Nocton 40mm f1.2 lens. This is a lens designed for Sony FE full-frame mirrorless and is one of the number of Voigtlander lenses that are really a whole lot like the classic Zeiss lenses, if you're familiar at all with that lineup. Much like the classic Zeiss lenses, they have an all metal and glass design, a beautiful knurled focus ring that glides along really smoothly. Like Zeiss classic lenses, this is a manual focus lens, has a manual aperture ring. However, it is electronically enabled, and so it will communicate XF data. It will give you focus assist on Sony bodies. It will communicate for steady shot and everything like that. And so, in many ways, although it is manual focus, it is one of the easier manual focus type lenses to use, much like the Zeiss Loxia series. And so today we are here to do a definitive review of this unique lens. And so as a part of that, we'll look in depth hands-on what you're getting in terms of the handling and the build. We'll break down the image quality in detail and give you a final verdict on it. Now, if you prefer your reviews to just not have all the details but more the conclusions, then I recommend that at the end of this week I'll release the standard review, that you take a look at that. And if you're watching after the fact, just look for the standard review. It should be out already. You can find it at this link here. And so we're going to start today by taking a close look at the build and the handling and give you an up-close look at this little lens that really for a f1.2 lens is very nicely compact. Let's take a look. And so up front here we have a functional pinch cap, 58mm, which is the same as the filter threads up front. It does include this rather shallow lens hood that's all in metal. Rather than bayoneting in, it does thread in, and so it will occupy the filter threads. However, as you can see, it is re-threaded on the inside of the lens hood, and so that you can use filters in there. In many ways, the compact nature of the lens hood means that it's easy to just leave it in place all the time, which is good because, you know, it doesn't actually thread on here when reversed. You can kind of pop it on, but, you know, that's probably not your best option. You know, the lens cap doesn't work right, and so it's best to just leave it in place at all times. Everything here is in metal, obviously, all metal and glass. In the back, you have electronic contacts, so all the appropriate information is communicated. There is no weather sealing, however. And so as far as communication, it'll let the camera know, you know, your aperture value, focal length, lens designation. It'll let it know for in-body image stabilization. It will also even magnify the affected portion of the image when you start to zoom. And so all of those things are, of course, useful. So the lower ring, like many classic Zeiss lenses, is that knurled metal. It's very, very nice. And every Voigtlander lens that I have used thus far has been beautifully damped. This is no exception. It just glides along in the way that only a very good manual focus lens can. Above that is a manual aperture ring. It's easy to use, and it is an actual mechanical aperture ring, even with the lens powered off. Or, you know, and not attached to a camera, you will mechanically move the actual aperture. But fortunately, within the camera, it will notify you as to what aperture value you have selected. And so that way, while the camera can't automatically select, there is no auto switch here. You do have to manually select your aperture. But if you know, happen to have the lens attached to the camera and your eye is pressed up to the viewfinder, as you make changes, they will show up in real time, and so you can actually see the changes to aperture. So it's always easy to know what aperture you actually have selected. So functionally, very nice there. You can see that as you focus, there is a very, very small barrel extension. You know, it's not a hugely noticeable one, but it does extend. And so it's at its most refracted position at infinity, and at its minimum focus distance, it is at its longest length. Now the lens itself is 2.76 inches in diameter, but only 2.33 inches long. That is 70mm by right under 60mm in length. It weighs in at a moderate 14.8 ounces or 420 grams. The aperture is 10 aperture blades, and so it will give you, I believe, a dexagonal shape. Now, at minimum focus distance, which is 35 centimeters, you have a moderate 0.16 times magnification. On the higher end of standard for a 50 millimeter type lens, there are some 40 millimeter lenses that have a better magnification than that. That figure is, of course, useful, however, though not as useful as a higher magnification figure would be. All in all, however, this is obviously a very, nice fit in terms of size on a camera. The focus ring really falls to hands easy. The aperture ring is easy to access and use. So functionally, it's a nice lens to use. So as you can see, unlike my review of the 110mm f2.5 that I recently did, there's not really the handling type issues that are there. Yes, this is, again, a screw-in lens hood, like on all the Voigtlander lenses that I've seen so far. However, because it is so small, it really is not any kind of issue to just put it on and leave it there, which is what I've done here. I also much prefer the placement of the manual aperture ring, and so I have nothing but good to say about that. And then also the focus throw here, I think, is quite appropriate to the lens itself, and so no issues there as well. So overall handling, really the only thing I'm going to criticize here is that, I do wish that it had weather sealing. As a premium lens, I feel like that is something at this price point that probably should be a part of Voigtlander's, kind of design and plans. And so I will knock it for that. But otherwise, this is it's a gorgeous lens aesthetically, and it also functions very well if you're familiar with using manual focus lenses. Now, as far as the actual focus goes, like I noted, the focus throw here is, I think, roughly about 130 degrees, 125 degrees. And I found that enough in basically every situation that I was in to be able to focus with precision without getting too lost in the weeds of having to do really long focus pulls. And so no issue there. So this makes this a better option if you're looking for a lens for video work. It's got a nice, a nice amount of damping, and it's a nice focus throw for that. The other thing that I found is that for shooting portraits, I was able to do that effectively. We'll talk a little bit more about this lens in the image quality in just a second, but just note that I was able to get accurate results with focus assist, and then focus overlays, but I mostly like visual confirmation with manual focus lenses. So what focus assist is that it will, as soon as you begin to do focus input, it will automatically magnify the active portion that's being focused on, and so it helps you to see that either through the viewfinder on the LCD and visually confirm focus. So, a nice addition there for that. So let's jump in and let's take a look at the image quality situation. It's a little bit of a complicated picture here, and so there's kind of a dual nature of this lens that we will explore. So let's jump in and let's take a look.
So we'll start off by taking a look at distortion and vignette. And so as you can see, there is a mild amount of a pincushion distortion, which is not extreme at all, but there's just a little bit there. Nothing really to be concerned about on that front. As you can see, it corrects with the profile nice and easily. Now, there's obviously much more vignette associated here, and at f1.2, you've got a vignette, however, that's really quite linear. You can see that it's not like super dark in the corners, but it just kind of gradually moves throughout the frame. Obviously, it corrects fine, no problem. It's also the type of vignette that in many shots is going to look look good because it's not extreme. It's just kind of distributed out fairly evenly. So another thing that really kind of pops up is that there is definitely a lot of a surface blur, a chromatic aberration that affects the ability to render kind of sharp images. And so as we look at it with my test here for longitudinal chromatic aberration, you can see that while there is some longitudinal chromatic aberration, it's actually not extreme. What you mostly have is just a generalized lack of contrast at f1.2. You can see that at f2 it's starting to improve, and so you're getting more definite lines and thus your sharpness increasing. So what we're going to see as we move ahead is less a byproduct of any kind of extreme longitudinal chromatic aberration, but basically just kind of aberrations in general that cause a lack of contrast at wide apertures. So if we take it into high contrast situations, you can see what I'm talking about in that you can actually see a little bit of a purple tinge to all of this at f1.2 on the left, but it's not that it manifests so much as fringing out on the edges. It's more that you can tell that there is some fringing there, but it's more just in a general lack of contrast. If we look here at f2.8, you can see how radically that has all cleared up, and it allows for dramatically sharper looking images as a byproduct. So at f1.2, if we take a look at our sharpness, you kind of see what you expect. Now, the reality is that if you look past the generalized haze, the lens is not soft. I can actually see the text that is there, but there's such a low contrast at f1.2 that it almost seems like there's a little bit of a Vaseline smear over the top of everything. And that gives you an appearance of non-sharpness. There's just not a lot of contrast that's there in those kind of surface blurs. The same is true here. We look at this bill, there's actually a fair amount of acuity there. You can see that detail is being resolved quite well. You can also see that there is just a tiny bit of lateral chromatic aberration, but it's not all that strongly pronounced. And looking off into the corner, now we can see that there is a real loss of contrast here towards the extreme corner. But even here, there is detail there. There's just really low contrast, and that gives it a kind of a dreamy, wide open type look. Now, what's interesting here is that in this image right here, the global contrast actually looks pretty good. If you look at the image just full on resolution, it actually looks quite good. But if you jump into, a pixel level, and this is actually a little past a pixel level, this is a 2:1 just to allow you to see the details on your playback, you can see the same kind of thing I'm talking about. There is resolution there. I mean, but what there also is this kind of haze, and you can really see it as the kind of a chromatic aberration kind of around this high contrast area. And so it doesn't allow detail to really pop here at wide apertures. Here's another real world example at f1.2. Globally, I actually really like the image. You can tell that the bokeh is lovely on this lens, really soft. But once again, if you jump into a pixel level, what you see is you can definitely see the chromatic aberration and that kind of general lack of contrast at a pixel level, micro contrast. And so those aberrations make for a softer, dreamier kind of rendering. So what happens as we start to stop down? Well, here's just a 1/3 stop to f1.4. And so taking a look here, you can see that there is a very, very mild improvement of contrast. However, there's no big uptick that's taking place at f1.4, just a mild improvement of your contrast. That's not the case, however, if we move on to f2. So looking at the difference between f1.2 and f2, you can see that now that contrast is coming here. And so the detail that was always there, you're starting to be able to see it now with that kind of hazy effect gone. Here at mid-frame, you can see vastly improved contrast, which allows, again, the details to shine. Moving off into the corner, you can see a huge improvement in the corner to where it looks much crisper and much more contrast there. Here's a real world example that shows you how this plays out. This is f2.2, but you can see looking in at a 2:1 pixel level that there's actually, the image is really sharp and crisp. If you step back to a global level, you can see that there's a nice three-dimensional pop to the lens with our two subjects. You can see that it fades away really, really nicely. From f2 to f2.8, you can see steadily improving contrast, which results in, also some higher looking resolution. Here we can see again, continued improved contrast. And so you can see now that the kind of the detail in this, pattern that's back here is starting to pop out more. Finally, off in the corner, you can see contrast is really starting to pop up to a nice level here at f2.8. So this is in the Luray Caverns in Virginia, f2.8. And so here, obviously I wanted to keep my ISO, at a reasonable level. And so I didn't want to stop down the lens too much. But you can see in this image that it's captured a lot of detail here across the frame at a pixel level. And so, it definitely did the trick when I stopped the lens down a little bit. Now by f4 for a landscape type setting, you can see that now my detail looks really, really good. This is on a Sony a7R Mark III, and so this is 42 megapixels. You can see right off into the edges and the corners. Beautiful, beautiful contrast in the lens, which is ironic for how little contrast it has to start up at wide apertures. But when you stop down, it's really doing a great job of rendering the fine details here. And of course, trademark is beautiful color out of Voigtlander lenses. Another example here, f5.6. And so you can see, just looking out across the image, I mean, look at in the cars in the distant parking lot here, it's really resolving the fine details exceptionally well on the side of this hill. Like, it's really amazing how crisp the lens gets, considering how kind of dreamy and soft it is wide open. Now, this represents your maximum magnification, I believe 0.16 times, so just average. But this is at f2.8. You can see that if you stop down the lens a little bit, its ability to give you great contrast and detail at minimum focus is very strong. I mean, that looks great. Now, the trade-off for that kind of dreamy, wide-open rendering is, of course, really, really beautiful bokeh. And so you can see, this isn't a long focal length, so it's not obliterating the background by compression. This is just really, really nice and soft blur. So if we look at the focus point, you know, there's enough there, but it's not mind-blowing. It's not, you know, super impressive in terms of the sharpness and contrast there. But the rendering here is really beautiful. Another case in point here. And so this being kind of a high contrast subject, you can really see that it's quite soft here. But as you start to look at the bleed away to the defocus, you can see that the background blur is super, super soft. And here, if you stop down a little bit, you obviously start to get the contrast in the subject. And we'll take a peek at a pixel level here. And so, you know, it looks good there in terms of the contrast and the detail. And the bokeh is obviously not as soft, but it continues to render nicely even when stopped down. Here's another comparison of f1.2 and f2.8 in a real-world setting. So you can obviously see there's a big difference in the amount of contrast on the subject when you stop down to f2.8. But again, your trade-off is that beautifully soft background at f1.2 is just, it's not quite as magical at f2.8. So there's kind of your trade-off in this situation. Here's a shot that I used for another review. And you can see that this is actually at f2.8. And so here I'm maximizing sharpness. So the image is nice and sharp, but we continue to have quite nice background blur in this particular image. And so, you know, the trade-off is that I really like the end result. So how about for portraits? So, I mean, the lens has beautiful color. We've already established that. For portraits, it depends on what your priority is. In this case, you can see that focus is correct on the eyelash, but there's just not a lot of acuity there on the details. Background is really nice. So, you know, if you are looking at more of a dreamy type portrait look, this could be a beautiful portrait lens. Stopping down to f1.4 for portraits, so 1.4 on the left. And so you can see you've upped the detail a bit here on the face and, you know, to what I would consider now acceptable levels. And you have retained a lot of the character of the background, and so that's certainly an option. Stopping on down to f2, you can take a look at the global look and the background. You can tell the contrast is starting to pop in, and now if you look at the face at f2, that looks really, really crisp. Everything looks nice and dark. And so, you know, definitely a real change from f1.4 to f2 in terms of your sharpness. And you can look again at the background now and determine whether or not that's appealing to you as a portrait type lens. So looking at bokeh here in terms of the geometry and the kind of the general busyness, so you can see the typical lemon shape, cat eye kind of shape. And if geometry is a big deal to you, Voigtlander may be a tough choice, and I'll show you why in just a second. You can see a little bit of concentric rings here in this bokeh highlight. It's not really obvious at a global level. You can see it at a pixel level, however, if that's a factor to you, certainly take that into mind. Now, I mentioned if geometry is a big deal to you, Voigtlander may not be for you, and here's the reason. Even stopping down to f1.4, look at that. You can definitely already see the shape of the aperture. And so you've got a high blade count, and so it is a circular type shape, but those straight aperture blades, which I'm not necessarily a fan of, you can definitely start to see them very quick. So this is f1.4, this is f2. And so you've got consistent geometry now, but you're definitely seeing those shapes and on down to f2.8 and just more so of that. So, you know, that may be a factor for some of you. So finally, let's take a look for astrophotography. Any lens with a large maximum aperture like f1.2, people are going to consider it as an option for shooting the night sky. And so let's take a look at how it holds up. So center of the frame looks decent, other than the fact that on bright points, you can see that kind of chromatic aberration. You can see almost like a flaring bleeding effect that takes place. Bleeding is maybe the better word for that we saw in other situations. Now, as you move towards the edge, you've got both the bleeding effect, but you've also starting to see some coma. And so you see what looks like geese flying away for the winter in the corners. And so, I mean, that's what is called coma. So if we stop on down to F1.4, we can see that it really hasn't done a whole lot to cure either one of those issues. Down to F2, you can definitely see the coma is reduced now to, you know, much more acceptable levels, and also that bleeding is mitigated somewhat. And so at this point, you know, your mileage may vary what's acceptable to you. I think that this is a usable end result, and certainly, again, like if you own the lens, then certainly you can use it for this. Don't buy the lens for this because it's not necessarily a strength. It does some things very well, but this isn't necessarily a big strong point. And so perhaps you can understand what I meant by the somewhat complicated nature of the lens, its mix of being kind of dreamy and its rendering wide open while being exquisitely sharp when stopped down. In some ways, it reminds me of the classic Zeiss planar 50mm f1.4, and that lens also was probably even softer than this wide open, not a lot of contrast, but then became very sharp stopped down. And in some ways, I think this lens has a similar character, a very nice bokeh and a very soft rendering. And, you know, for example, in this portrait shot at f1.2, if we go into the details, it's not particularly sharp. However, if you look at the image globally, it's beautiful. Beautiful color, looks, the kind of global contrast is fine. The micro contrast at wide open or f1.4 is not great. It gets better by f2. By f2.8, it's fantastic. And then stop down, you know, for example, in this image, I think that the amount of detail rendered there is, it rivals pretty much anything that I've ever put on a, you know, 42 megapixel A7 R3 body before. So really a dual nature. So at the end of the day, who is this lens for? Now, a lot of people, when they look at f1.2 lenses these days, they look at it with a different perspective than people used to. I think that, you know, you go back 10, 15 years, people with an f1.2 lens, they didn't expect it to be razor sharp, wide open. That's changed, however, now, and some people have differing expectations. Lenses like either Canon's RF 50mm or 85mm f1.2 lenses. Those lenses are incredibly sharp, wide open. The new Sigma 35mm f1.2 on Sony is likewise incredibly sharp, corner to corner f1.2. Those lenses are also massive, however. And so this is kind of a classic aesthetic here in that the lens, it's not razor sharp at f1.2. There's actually a pretty decent amount of sharpness there, but that kind of surface blur, surface haze eliminates the contrast. And so it's not until the lens is stopped down to f2 or smaller that you really start to get that popping kind of image quality. However, there's also a certain charm to the rendering from this lens that sometimes is missed with sharper lenses. And so I think it really boils down to your priorities as a photographer. If you kind of like the, you know, kind of the aesthetic look, that it's more about the feel of an image than it is about the details, the Nocton 40mm f1.2 might be a great lens for you. However, if you're looking for something that's going to be, super sharp at f1.2, this is not going to be your pick. Now, to be fair, however, lenses that are sharp corner to corner, they're going to be much larger than this. And so there is another trade-off that comes as a part of that. At about $950 US for this lens, it's not a cheap lens. However, it is a lens that will last you for a lifetime. It's beautifully made. Ironically, lenses like this are quite future-proof because all of the control is right on the lens itself. And so I'm still using lenses sometimes that are 50 plus years old because both the aperture and the focus can be controlled right from the lens. And so, I mean, that's something to consider possibly as well. And so not for everyone. For some people though, I suspect you're going to love it. And you get to make that choice for yourself.
If you want more information, I recommend that you take a look at the image gallery that's linked to, or my full text review that kind of covers things in a thorough fashion. So take a look at those, both linked to in the description down below. There's also buying links if you want to purchase one there for yourself. And beyond that, there's linkage to follow me on social media, to become a patron, to sign up for my newsletter, ways you can support this channel. Thanks for watching today, and I hope you have a great day.